relatively easy target. Another GAO report in 1988 determined that the Department of Energy nuclear laboratories were far too open to foreign visitors. Quote, countries identified as sensitive by DOE because there is security and or proliferation risk, such as Pakistan and Israel, unquote. The report found that, quote, of 637 visitors from countries such as India, Israel, and Pakistan, the DOE required background checks for only 77, unquote. And in addition to amassing critical knowledge, other nuclear technologies freely flowed from the U.S. to Israel, including dual-use technologies such as klystrons and krytons. In May of 1985, former Air Force and NATO advisor Richard Kelly Smith, no relation, was charged by a federal grand jury with smuggling over 800 krytons to Israel. The kryton can be used to trigger nuclear weapons. Federal law forbade their sale overseas without a permit. At the time of his arrest, Smith was president of an export and engineering business in Huntington Beach, California, named Milco International Corporation. Milco provided aviation consulting through U.S. military contracts as well as sales and export facilitation. Milco had close ties with Aaron Milchan. In the early 80s, billionaire Aaron Milchan did not seem like a likely candidate for any involvement in nuclear technology smuggling. He's a dual citizen of Israel and Monaco, and close personal friend of Shimon Peres, which is a common denominator in many of these nuclear initiatives. Milchan was most widely known in the U.S. as a Hollywood film mogul. Smith jumped bail and disappeared overseas for more than a decade. Afterwards, Milchan publicly denied that he had done anything illegal during interviews with NBC News in 1982 and 1993. But in July of 2001, Smith was arrested in Costa del Sol in Malaga, Spain, and at the age of 72, extradited back to the United States and held without bail for trial in California. He was found guilty of violating Arms Export Control Act and issuing false statements to government agencies, fined $20,000 and sentenced to 40 months in federal prison. But the big operators behind that operation walked free. This has been the recurring theme of arms and technology smuggling to Israel. Some speculate, including this GAO report, which again, I advise everyone to read, it's fascinating stuff. Whether, in this, it says, quote, the material was diverted to Israel by NUMEC management with the assistance of the Central Intelligence Agency, or, quote, again from this report, there has been a cover-up of the NUMEC incidents by the United States government. Milchan stated, before Smith was extradited back to the United States, that, quote, there's nothing that the U.S. and Israel do separately, unquote. But he's since gone silent about the krytons. So the question is, has the United States officially, yet secretly, been arming Israel with nuclear weapons technology? There is no evidence of that yet. In the early 1960s, as the problems for NUMEC were beginning, President John F. Kennedy, and this is something Jeff referred to, was unleashing not only a robust nuclear non-proliferation initiative, heavily targeting the Israelis, but also a law enforcement and accountability maneuver. He not only demanded U.S. inspections of the Dimona nuclear weapons plant, but on November 21, 1962, his brother, Attorney General Robert F. Kennedy, ordered Israel's elite American lobby to register as foreign agents under the Foreign Agents Registration Act after the American Zionist Council was discovered laundering tax-exempt Jewish agency funds into U.S. lobbying and public relations campaigns. The full Department of Justice case file on that was declassified and released by the National Archives in 2008. And it now appears on the internet if you simply search for American Zionist Council. During a December 27, 1962 meeting with Foreign Minister Golda Meir, Kennedy expressed his hope that the relationship was, quote, a two-way street, unquote. Meir reassured the president that there would, quote, not be any difficulty between us on the Israeli nuclear reactor, unquote. Kennedy delivered an ultimatum to Israel on July 5, 1963, insisting that Dimona undergo serial inspections, quote, in accord with international standards, unquote, in order to verify its peaceful intent. This occurred as a letter-writing campaign organized by the American Council for Judaism was bombarding the Kennedy Justice Department with telegrams urging that the American Zionist Council be forced to register as a foreign agent. On October 11, 1963, the DOJ gave the American Zionist Council a 72-hour deadline to register as Israel's foreign agent. Kennedy's assassination in November not only traumatized the nation, but led to the gradual reversal of both the non-proliferation effort as applied to Israel and foreign agent registration drive. Israeli Prime Minister David Ben-Gurion's secret 1958 arrangement with Abraham Feinberg now placed Israel's key nuclear weapons benedictor in the heart of the Johnson administration. According to Seymour Hersh's excellent book, The Samson Option, quote, there's no question that Feinberg enjoyed the greatest presidential access and influence in his 20 years as a fundraiser and lobbyist with Lyndon Johnson. Documents at the Johnson Library show that even the most senior members of the National Security Council understood that any issue raised by Feinberg had to be answered, unquote. As with Truman, Feinberg played a timely and powerful role in financing Lyndon B. Johnson's election prospects. Scrutiny of Israel's nuclear weapons program gradually reversed, and the Dimona inspections regime, as documented by Cohen, soon became an embarrassing farce for both the United States and Israel. Feinberg's cash was king in the Johnson administration. As documented by Hersh, on October 14, 1964, less than 3 weeks before presidential elections, Johnson's top administrative assistant, Walter Jenkins, was arrested in a public restroom on sexual solicitation charges. At least $250,000 Feinberg had raised for Johnson was located in Jenkins' office safe. Johnson phoned his trusted aides, Bill Moyers and Meyer Feldman, were ordered to move all the cash, which they could only do with a heavy briefcase. In a kind of ongoing global swap, Israel replenished Feinberg's coffers, as it arranged with Zalman Shapiro through sales commissions, with multi-million-dollar favors, such as a major interest, ownership interest, in Israel's Coca-Cola franchise. In 1968, Hersh documents that Secretary of Defense Clark Clifford placed a final urgent call to Johnson, stating, quote, Mr. President, I don't want to live in a world where the Israelis have nuclear weapons, unquote. But it was too late. President Johnson was abrupt before he hung up on Clifford, saying, don't bother me with this anymore. By the time Israeli Prime Minister Golda Meir lobbied President Nixon to define the U.S. non-proliferation policy with an exemption of ambiguity toward Israeli nuclear weapons, Israel's stockpile and number of deployed weapons was steadily growing. So the question is, why don't any of these high-level operators ever go to jail for this kind of behavior in the United States? Why are they above the law? Few perpetrators of highly illegal conventional and nuclear smuggling activities for Israel have ever faced any meaningful consequences. The organizations and individuals of the 1940s Sonnenbohr Institute Haganah Conventional Arms Smuggling Network engaged in charitable activities and had front companies to cover war material theft and smuggling. They intertwined with sympathetic elites across U.S. politics, business, and government, which is made it all but impossible as a target for law enforcement. After some Sonnenbohr Network members were arrested in Canada moving machine gun parts across the Canadian border, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police